say anyway.
Mike's Daily Podcast.
Episode 1002. Hello, it is Mike Matthews broadcasting from Cafe Anyway, located somewhere in Podcastro Valley, Mont. At the last place on Earth. Today, it's Benita, the Disgruntled Fiddle Player, the Brewmaster, plus during this week where we've passed the 1,000 mark of podcasts I've done. We look back at past podcasts and
Mike's Daily Podcast.
Precursor shows to Mike's Daily Podcast. Oh, there were a couple shows before this one that, yikes.
Mike's Daily Podcast.
Not so good, but we'll zip through all of them. And so, do all dentists try to steal your money when you go in for a cleaning? And they act funny. You need to get this special photo taken of your teeth before you're done. The stuff not covered by your insurance seems to cost a ton. Eek. Eek. That's why
Mike's Daily Podcast.
The average time is quite long between dentist visits. Let's all say goodbye to
Mike's
Downton Abby.
Daily Podcast.
Everything seemed to end well.
Yeah.
On that show, Maggie Smith didn't die. Spoilers. She did have the last line in the show. She said, something like the other character says, we have to go into the... because it's New Year's Eve. And she's like, oh, we make a big deal about the future. She says, I wish I could stay in the past. Something like that. Anyway, Cafe Anyway. It worked out well. It was good. There was a lot of characters that had a lot of hard times. Good things happened to them. And then there was some people came back that had been gone. That girl that's in that Cinderella movie, she came back, and it made me go, British people, they're really well dressed, and they speak really well. And then why is it they eat such bland stuff? I don't get it. What, you never see a burrito in Downton Abbey. And I wonder why that is. I really do. I'm having a deep thought process. But look, who just walked in.
Hi, Mike. It's Benita the Rodeo Queen. Hi, I'm doing.
It's a disgruntled fiddle player, tell you what.
What?
The reason why there are no burritos in Downton Abbey is because they did not have the technology. It was not... Back then, the thought of taking a long, flat pancake and wrapping delicious meats and beans and guacamole in there, that was beyond their concept. It was like talking to them from some other dimension.
Oh, okay. So that was my little review of Downton Abbey, and now here's another Mike's Absolutely Useless Review.
Mike's Absolutely Useless Review.
Doctor Who. Well, I've got two British shows here. It's all British shows, I guess, this episode. But Doctor Who had their last episode of their season, Peter Capaldi's second season on Doctor Who. This is the season that saw Jenna Coleman leave. She left the episode before this last one, this Christmas episode. And all of a sudden, River Song is back. Alex Kingston. And she's fantastic. She's magnificent. And she plays a character that has known three doctors now. She's the wife of the doctor. She, at one point in this episode, tells some servant of hers to go look for the doctor, and she goes, he'll look like any of these 12 faces. And there you go, there's all the pictures of from William Hartnell all the way down to Matt Smith, even including the war doctor played by John Hurt. And Peter Capaldi wasn't in any of those pictures, so the episode is sort of like her discovering that the new doctor, the Peter Capaldi doctor, is who he is. And the best line is when she discovers that it's him. She's like, you need to get your roots done. And he says to her when she, to like say hello, you know, he does the hello, sweetie, which she says to him all the time. Hey, it's a great episode. I enjoyed it. And it's sort of the last River Song one we'll ever see, because they allude to in the show that that she's just about to, the next thing that she's going to be doing after she leaves the Peter Capaldi doctor is go see the David Tennant doctor in the episode where they are on the library planet, and those weird aliens that disintegrate people in their spacesuits and eat all their flesh and all that. That whole episode is going to happen, where her soul gets uploaded to some matrix thing and she will live forever that way. But yeah, I mean, I guess they could bring her back in other things. And I hear that, I'm just jumping around. I can't make a sentence here to save my life.
Max, slow it down. You get all talking about your Doctor Who thing, you get all flustered.
I know, Benita. And, okay. Alex Kingston is doing the, what they call Big Finish. Big Finish does these Doctor Who radio specials, basically what was popular for a long time on the BBC radio stations is they would do like our old time radio shows, like we did with the Green Hornet and Lone Ranger and Fibber McGee and Molly and the Jack Benny show and whatnot. So they have continued that tradition. Well, now here into the 21st century and 2016, and they have a series that follows River Song, as well as Torchwood. They've got Captain Jack Harkness. That whole series continues on the audiobooks, which they're kind of funny because the actor, since it's all about their voice, some actors don't know how to act with their voice. They know how to act physically, but it's weird. Some of them, with just the audio world, they sound a little lost. I don't know. But Alex Kingston does her River Song series, so she lives on in the audio shows. But yeah, so the next episode is supposed to be the David Tennant thing for her timeline. Yeah. It was great to see her come back. Oh, the other review. Foyle's War is a TV show with Michael English. And he plays this detective. Craig Ferguson used to talk about him quite a lot when he was doing his late night show. It's a show where he's a detective in World War II England. He's a police detective and he solves crimes. And it's kind of interesting because they move in the, you know, through historical situations that influence his characters. The Nazis tried to bomb parts of England, and, you know, England being under siege and that whole situation and the fear that England was going through. And now, since the show's been going on for, I think, over 10 years, they are doing episodes of post-World War II and the Nazi trials, and also the Russians are everywhere now. The Russians are trying to get the secrets for the atom bomb, etc. So it's a fascinating show. There's the main character, Foyle, Detective Foyle, is very straight-laced and asks questions, and he's like no nonsense. He doesn't joke around or anything, but he's still very amusing. His assistant, who's been the assistant with him since the very first episode, is an actress by the name of Honeysuckle Weeks. And she was just a young gal in the beginning, and now she's grown up. It's kind of funny that she's still doing the show. I mean, it's great, and you've seen her grown up. And she is a great character in the show because she's very loyal to Foyle and loyal to Foyle. Foyle's War. And the new season, or the latest season anyway, is on Netflix, if you want to watch that. I think you can get caught up with all the shows. Each episode, though, is long. It's sort of like the way Downton Abbey was. The Doctor Who episodes are around 45 minutes, but the Foyle episodes are about an hour and a half. But very fascinating, and you learn a lot about the history of England, of which I am somewhat obsessed with. So I mentioned the last show that I'm too fat for the pearl snaps. What a pearl snap collared shirt that I have. I tried putting it on the other day, and I realized that the holidays had had their effect on me. Because the pearl snaps would not stay snapped shut. And I would sit down, and they'd start popping open, and I'd be like, dang. Is this like a flubber situation? Am I growing here? What's going on? So,
Mark, you need to stay away from the holiday leftovers.
Yeah, Mark. Throw it all in a soup. Make a gumbo.
Excellent tip. Oh, look, Welsh just walked in.
Oh, Mark, I make the root beer. I'm the brewmaster. Oh, boy.
Brewmaster, I was listening to one of the old shows that I'll be playing in just a second here. You were on a show, an early podcast that I did in 2009 when I was trying to resurrect the old Santa Fe Cafe in a different incarnation, and I was just not figuring it out. But for one thing, I am extremely self-conscious about doing the character voices when there are other people around. It's weird. I can do it for you that is listening right now, but to have someone actually in the room, it depends. Like, Haley could be in the room, Kevin, addendum with Kevin, he can be in the room, I can do it, but like my ex-wife, she'd be walking around the house and I'd be recording in our room, in our office, and I just felt so like she was kind of, she set me off, it threw me off, like I couldn't quite focus and do it, and anyway. Cafe, anyway. It's hard to explain. It was hard to block her out when I was doing the characters. At any rate, I have pearl snaps that are popping off.
And I was in an early show?
Yeah.
How did that sound?
You sounded like yourself, but like kind of like this.
Did I make the root beer?
You made root beer?
Did I make pearl snaps pop off my shirt?
You sure? Yes. You know, I noticed our 1,000th episode, the show went really into a really, really weird space. I listened to the end of it the next day, and I heard the whole thing. We were talking about the Laws that do that song, There She Goes, and Haley was singing the song, and I'm like, that's a song, that's a band. The Laws, that had one album. They always thought the lead singer was a genius. He did like all the work on the album. And then they tried to get him into the studio to do another song, another album, and he just totally burnt out. It's a fascinating story about him. The Sixpence None the Richer, Lee Nash, sang the other famous version of There She Goes, which was actually crossed over onto all the charts, the hot adult contemporary charts, etc. And that was a big hit. So, I don't know. I felt weird. It was hard to end the 1,000th episode. It was sort of like now we're into a new world, a new realm of the thousands. It's and here we are, 1,002. And I have to go see the dentist, and they're gonna upsell me like crazy. I'm gonna walk in there. I just want my teeth cleaned. Oh well. The fluoride we're going to put on your teeth, that's another 100. So I'm excited for that. It's just, I'm trying to get all this stuff out of the way at the beginning of the year. All these appointments. All these things. That I've been putting off for so long. One weird thing I've been putting off for a long time is getting a new phone. I really like my phone, even though it's like now at the Stone Age. It's so old. The technology is not, it just can't keep up with all the new updates they've done to all the apps and everything. But it's something, this phone just, it's my friend. Oh, this is an interesting story that popped up. I don't know if you heard about this. There's they're going to build a building in Seattle. It's 102 stories, but the FAA said, no, don't make this building. Because one of the reasons, it's located too close to Seattle's airports and, interestingly enough, the headquarters of aircraft manufacturer Boeing. It will be a hazard. The people building it, it's a Miami-based company that's building it. So it's kind of like why Seattle would even let this happen is crazy. Okay, and that's pretty much it. Oh, that and on this date, Nancy Kerrigan got beaten up by that guy that Tanya Harding hired. Remember that whole thing? That was 20 years ago. No, 22 years ago. Jeez. Mike'sDailyPodcast.com is this wonderful website that has all the past shows if you want to listen to those and see all the past podcast pictures and hear my past interviews with people from Seattle and other places, San Francisco, etc. And if you want to help us out, there is a link to the Amazon link there at Mike'sDailyPodcast.com. If you're going to buy anything on Amazon, click on that link and buy whatever it is you're going to buy, and that helps us out. And if you'd also like to help us out through the PayPal, there's a PayPal link there, and you can become an inglorious Mike's Daily Podcaster, and all the characters can wish you well, which is what you need at the beginning of the year. All that is at Mike'sDailyPodcast.com. The first show from way back, let's listen to... Okay, so the very first thing I tried to do was a show called The Messy Desk, which was I was trying to record a show from my house and upload it to the internet in 2009, which very few people are doing that at this point. Very few people have figured out that their Macs, that their Apple products can do that. I don't even know if any of the Apple products had GarageBand on them yet. I know it was something that was starting to happen, but I was using a PC, and I had some software that I'd gotten from a radio station, and so I started recording using just mics that I just had lying around, and this is what ended up happening. Welcome to the show. Hi, it's Michael Matthews with the special podcast we're doing live from The Messy Desk.
I love Huntsville, Alabama. I live here with my llama. I own a llama, a rama llama, damn a llama, am a llama in Alabama. Ask me, what do you feed that thing? It looks so big, it must eat everything. You know I just rhymed everything with the word thing. That kinda was a cheating way of rhyming something. Do you notice these chords don't go good with each other? There's this one, then this one. This one, then this one, they don't go together, and that's kind of really annoying. But what can I do? What can I do? I had no formal education on the piano at all, so I must say,
I got lost for a second. This literally is a messy desk, so we have named the show correctly. So the first bit of news is the guy who was Deep Throat died. His name was Mark Felt. Now, nobody knew who he was for a long, long time. There was all kinds of conjecture and theory. Who was Deep Throat? Mark Felt died. He was the Deep Throat guy. He died at 95. Brought down Nixon, but no one knew who he was for 25 years. Bye bye, Deep Throat guy. Then I tried another attempt and it sounded like this. Oh, yeah, this was my first interview that I did completely at home. Before, you would do an interview over the phone at a radio station. Well, radio stations are all set up for this sort of thing. They've got all the stuff there. They use this system called Telos, and it's all done for you. But now I had to figure out how to do this at home, which I ended up taking my cell phone and plugging it in to the computer. It was this weird sort of jerry-rigged thing, and it sounded like this. I talked to my friend from Colin, my friend Colin, who's from England now. He's in England now. I knew him from the radio industry, and then I went and visited him in Washington, D.C., so we had a little chat over the phone. So in Washington, D.C., there you've got the Obama inauguration happening next Monday, right?
Next Tuesday.
The 20th.
Yes.
So what is happening?
There's going to be a massive crowd of people. I hear up to 5 million people descending on the city. And I saw the parade route yesterday and what they have blocked off. They have probably about 40 square blocks of the D.C. area blocked off from before the Capitol on one end to past the White House on the other, blocked off from traffic of any kind. You have to take Metro to get anywhere. And then public access is actually limited to, I think, just the National Mall with the monuments and the green grassy area just outside of the Capitol up through, like, the Washington Monument.
Have you talked to anybody that's, like, in town that has traveled there that has come for the inauguration to see our first
I have not yet. I don't know if they're here yet.
Okay.
Or if they are, I haven't talked to them yet.
It's exciting. Is it palpable? Can you feel the excitement?
I definitely feel it. I actually went to a museum on Sunday, and they'd already set up porta potties a week and a half out.
Wow.
Almost 2 weeks in advance.
I hope they're locked up. Cause
I imagine they probably are.
Anybody can just walk in and use that.
Yeah. It looks like there's a lot of planning involved, and it's going to be quite the shindig.
Come for the shindig in Washington, D.C.
Yes. Come to the inauguration, stay for the shindig.
And then I tried to bring back some of the Santa Fe Cafe characters. This was with the Brewmaster, as I mentioned before. You are witnessing the grand opening right now here at the cafe. Let's see, is anybody... None of my employees seem to be working at the moment. They're all huddled around the root beer maker and the Brewmaster. Brewmaster, how's it going so far?
Matt, I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of people here, and nobody seems to know what they're going to drink.
Well, one of the wonderful things about the cafe is that we actually make our own root beer. And sarsaparilla.
Matt, there's hardly any difference.
That I don't even know what I named that podcast. I don't think I think I called it just The Cafe. But that was just one episode. Episode. I've always called these episodes. And then we went into the last place on Earth, which was more of a cafe idea. And I got the idea actually from a guy that worked for an NPR station in Huntsville, Alabama. I was still living in Alabama during all this time in 2009. I hadn't moved back to California yet. And this guy from a NPR station there told me, hey, we would love to play a show that kind of sounds like your old Santa Fe Cafe stuff that you did on K-Hey. The guy had heard that. I had that up on my MySpace. Yeah, this is MySpace is still around in 2009. And so he suggested I try and make a show that would sound a little bit like the Santa Fe Cafe, but maybe with music that they would want to play, that was a little more obscure, kind of up-and-coming artists, independent artists, that sort of thing. Anyway, I tried that with this show. Hey, that sounded like my uncle in Germany, Uncle Jupp. Hey, it's Mike Matthews. I am here in a really cool place. It is called The Last Place on Earth. And I'm happy to be here because, we've been doing the podcast picnic from all kinds of different places. And now it's fine fine to have it here, and then I start to sing. You see, the summer's almost gone, and I don't worry about my lung.
I'm the last place on earth,
because it don't exist like my name on Santa's list.
On the last place on earth.
I once had a radio show. It was great. It lasted 12 years. And it was late. Then the company moved me to a foreign state. Then they fired me because they started to deflate. But that wasn't my fault, because I did just what they taught.
On the last place on earth.
And they're going soon, you'll see, into bankruptcy.
On the last.
The last place.
Place on earth. Yeah!
Well, he ended up not wanting the show, which is all right, no hard feelings, whatever. Then we moved to California, and I tried to keep the last place on earth going. And I did about 24 shows. Each one was half hour long. I was trying to get the show played on any NPR station. I was shopping it around to any station in the U.S. And then I realized no one cared. So I said, hell with it. I'm going to do my own podcast. And I renamed it Mike's Daily Podcast. Go ahead and tell your name to everyone.
Masu, my name is Madame Rootabega.
Ah, Madame Rootabega. It's so great that you're here on Mother's Day, because you've been such a motherly figure to all of us here, and you've been predicting our future, or you did back in the late 90s to the early 00s, and you were completely right on top about everything, about how there would someday be a massive internet company called Noseface, and that there would be people flying around on hoverboards, and that was all right on.
Thank you, Masu, and I can look into your future right now. I see that if you wait a little bit longer, you will be able to wear those jeans, because they'll be coming back into style.
That is wonderful motherly advice. Thank you so much, Madame Rootabega.
Thank you, Matthew.
And that debuted on May the 7th, 2011. And actually, that was a little bit from the second FF episode. So now, 1,002 FF episodes later, we're still going. And thanks to you for listening to the show. It's tough to do a podcast. I have said from the very beginning, everybody should do a podcast. We all need to be heard. We all should express ourselves. And podcasting is a very easy way. And then it's also a very easy way to listen, because you can do all kinds of other things while you're listening versus watching a YouTube show, which those, since 2009, have gotten much popular. Video, blogs, etc. But as we go outside a cafe anyway, we're bringing Mike's Daily Podcast somewhere in Podcaster Valley.
And here's today's podcast picture.
And the podcast picture is of what I did on New Year's Day. I ended up going to Point Isabel. That's where I got